Hello, and welcome to the next video in this series. In this video, we will talk about the front-end circuit design, right-leg drive, and lead-off detection schemes for ECG application. This diagram shows an analog front-end for a single-lead ECG system. We will spend the next few slides going through each of these blocks individually, so you can understand the purpose and operation of each block. This diagram shows three electrodes, the LA and RA electrodes that we know form lead 1, and of course our RLD electrode, which provides the bias voltage to the patient through a dedicated RLD amplifier. Following each electrode, there is typically some protection circuitry that is needed to isolate the patient from fault currents. It also serves to protect the ADC subsystem from overvoltage events, such as a high voltage shock from a defibrillator. Most applications then require some form of lead-off detection to verify that the electrodes are still connected to the patient and to monitor the connection quality. The lead-off detection block is followed by an instrumentation amplifier, or INA. The INA stage is needed to present a high input impedance and to provide gain. Finally, the signal is connected to the inputs of an analog-to-digital converter, or ADC. As you can see, this is actually a pretty complicated system with quite a few parts. It gets more complicated when you want to do a 3-LED ECG. As we learned from the previous videos, you only need two ADC channels to do a 3-lead ECG, since you can calculate the third lead. In this diagram, each lead is measured by two separate simultaneously sampling ADCs. A 12-lead ECG adds even more complexity to the system. In addition to the functional blocks discussed in the previous examples, there are also requirements to generate the Wilson Central Terminal, or WCT, voltage. Remember that this is needed to measure the chest leads V1 through V6. Let's focus first on the components in the input signal path before the INA stage. This diagram shows the typical front end for an ECG design. Generally, the components in front of the INA consist of three things. One, current limiting resistors. These serve a few purposes. First, all of the ECG standards require that current on the electrodes are limited in the event that the INA inputs are somehow shortened on the power supply rail. The resistance value depends on the amount of leakage current allowed by the medical standard and the rail voltage. Number two, common mode and differential anti-aliasing filters. Anti-aliasing filters are low-pass filters used to reject high-frequency noise. While this noise may exist beyond our bandwidth of interest, all sampling systems are subject to aliasing. These filters are needed to reject the noise up front in the analog domain. The pull frequency of the primary anti-aliasing filter is formed by the series resistance in each input and differential capacitor, or CDIF. We want the differential capacitor to be much larger than the common mode capacitors, since the differential RC filter is not subject to component mismatch and will not affect the common mode rejection, or CMR, of the measurement. We still need the common mode capacitors to filter out high frequency common mode signals, but it should not be the bulk of the filtering. Otherwise, the component tolerances can degrade our CMR. We'll talk about CMR in more depth when we discuss the right leg drive amplifier. And finally, number three, we need a diode circuit to protect against defibrillator shocks. A defibrillator can deliver voltages in the kilovolt range to help the patient restore normal heart rhythm. We need to make sure the devices on the boards are not damaged. From the shock. When properly designed, the diodes will clamp the input voltage to within the absolute maximum input voltage of the INA, and the resistors will limit the current that flows through the diodes. Some applications may prefer to not use the RLD electrode in order to reduce the number of connections and to save on cost. In this case, the input to the INA will need to be AC coupled using the series capacitor's C block. The input signal path will still look very similar to the DC coupled version. The exception is that a resistor divider between the supply rails is needed to set the DC common mode voltage, typically to mid-supply. Alternatively, a single pull-up resistor to an available mid-supply rail can also be used. The combination of these resistors and C-block form a high-pass filter that will block the floating bias voltage of the body. The cutoff frequency for the high-pass filters can be as low as 0.0, providing the ECG signal content. The combination of these resistors and C-block form a high-pass filter that will block the floating bias voltage of the body. The cutoff frequency for the high-pass filters can be as low as 0.05 Hz while providing the ECG signal content. Now let's examine the requirements of the INA in an ECG system. Important. One of the most important requirements that you will encounter in ECG applications is input bias current. There are strict specifications in ECG applications which require that the input bias current stays below a certain level. Generally, customers want input bias current to remain lower than a few nanoamperes. If a device specifies a maximum input bias current, that is preferred over a typical value. Input impedance is a similar requirement as ECG signals are very small and possess very little drive strength. Noise is also very important in certain ECG applications because the signal is relatively small and doctors need to be able to resolve very small characteristics of the signal. Current noise is important because the impedance between the patient and electrode can be very high. Even a little current noise can turn into a very large voltage noise in ECG systems. DC coupled systems need to attain high dynamic range. Power consumption is not always important, as most hospital equipment runs off a wall supply. However, as more and more ECG measurement systems are becoming mobile, consumer and even new hospital grade equipment is being designed for battery operation to allow patients and caregivers more mobility. Maintaining power within a few megawatts is a great selling point. Finally, CMRR is very important because a typical ECG system is exposed to a lot of common mode interference, such as 50 to 60 Hz power line noises. The patient pickup utility signals. The front end must have very good CMRR to ensure the noise does not pass through the signal chain. Not important. Generally, DC specifications like offset, gain error, and nonlinearity do not matter because the offset of the skin electrode contacts are typically much larger than errors introduced by an INA. In addition, drift is not usually a concern because the temperature range of the application is typically narrow. Finally, PSRR is generally not a concern if power supply design is done properly with adequate placement of power supply sources and decoupling capacitors. Common mode rejection is a very important issue in ECG data acquisition systems. ECG standards require minus 86 dB or better CMRR. As I mentioned before, common mode interference from power line frequencies can couple onto the patient and the cables, posing one of the most common challenges to measuring ECG. This diagram is showing a common mode signal being applied to inputs with two common mode RC filters and an INA that has very good CMRR. However, the common mode signal still reaches the output because the combination of the RC filters does not have good CMRR because of component mismatch due to the respective tolerances. The resulting CMRR due to component mismatch can be calculated using this formula. Since it is tough to get discrete components that are well matched, we have to find another way to take care of this. The right leg electrode can be driven by an amplifier that has negative common mode feedback implemented. In addition to providing the DC bias voltage, the RLD can also drive a common mode cancellation signal to the body to help suppress common mode AC signals as well. In this diagram, we see that the common mode signal is taken from the output of the fully differential INA by connecting each output to a summing junction. The summing junction is connected to the inverting input of the RLD amplifier. This forms a large negative feedback loop for common mode signals. Note that the non-inverting input of the RLD amplifier is biased to mid-supply, such that the output cancellation signal is centered around the DC bias voltage driven to the body. Next, let's discuss a common feature of ECG data acquisition systems, lead-off detection. Physicians using ECG to monitor their patients need to be alerted when an electrode becomes disconnected or no longer has a good quality connection. Generally, this is done through impedance sensing. On this slide, we show what's called DC leadoff detection, which is when a DC excitation source is used to determine the impedance of the electrode connection. On the left, we use pull-up and pull-down resistors along with comparators. When patient impedance becomes too large, the voltage of the positive or negative input to the INA will be pulled up or down, respectively. The comparators are set to trigger at a predetermined voltage, which corresponds to an impedance level, where the electrode is said to be disconnected from the patient. The system monitors the output of the comparators to see which electrode is off and warns the clinician. On the right, we have a current source leadoff detection, which works similarly. But instead of using a pull-up or down resistor, it uses an excitation current source. The same principle applies. When the impedance becomes too large, the voltage at the inputs of the comparators will cause them to trigger, indicating leadoff to the user. Since each INA input is connected to a separate comparator, the status of each individual electrode can be monitored at all times. The output of these comparators can be tied to a microprocessor for instant notification. AC-coupled systems, however, cannot use the DC leadoff detection method due to the series DC blocking capacitors. Since DC current cannot pass through the AC-coupled input, the excitation signal needs to be an AC signal. In the example in the diagram, we inject an AC current of a known magnitude and frequency onto the inputs. The output from the system will have some frequency component in the spectrum corresponding to the voltage generated by the excitation current and the patient electrode impedance. In post-processing, you can then calculate the impedance between the inputs by dividing the voltage of that frequency component with the known current magnitude. If the impedance measured is too large, the system can indicate to the user that the connection is not good. Unlike DC leadoff detection methods, the status of individual electrodes cannot be monitored using AC leadoff. If a leadoff event is detected, the device is used on that particular channel. The final stage in the ECG input signal chain is the analog-to-digital converter, or ADC. Past ECG systems typically use cheaper, low-resolution ADCs. In order to get the input-referred noise of the system low enough, the INA stage would need to be configured for a very large gain. This would not be able to tolerate the large offset voltage from the electrodes, so they would also need to AC-couple the inputs in order to use large gains without clipping the ADC. New ECG systems take advantage of high-resolution ADCs. They can afford to DC-couple the inputs to the INA, use a low gain, and take advantage of the wide dynamic range of the ADC to measure a small ECG signal on top of the large DC offset. In the next video, we will discuss the advantages that TI's Delta Sigma ADCs offer for ECG measurement applications. This concludes our introduction to the carabouts related to front-end design for ECG application. For more information, visit ti.com/medical. Thanks for watching.